تركهم على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. أما بعد, all praises due to Allah, we seek His guidance and His forgiveness, and we seek refuge in Allah from the evil of ourselves and the whispering of our desires. Whom Allah guides, no one can misguide, and whom He allows to be misled, no one can guide. And I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship except Allah alone, having no partner. Is His slave and His messenger and His perfect worshiper. It's a pleasure to be with you all here tonight. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes our gathering a gathering in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had told us about. And that is, مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِنْ بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says there's no group of people who ever gather in any house from the houses of Allah, and they recite the book of Allah, وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ بَيْنَهُمْ, and they teach it to each other, except that a number of things happen. Number one, the Sakinah descends upon them, tranquility. And the angels surround them with their wings. And three is mercy envelops them. And number four, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions them in His company. And so we hope and we pray that in this gathering here, that we experience these four things: the descent of tranquility, the envelopment of mercy, the surrounding of the angels with their wings, and the mentioning of the King of Kings in His gathering. And so today, inshallah, I'll be sharing. I'm here, inshallah, to teach a seminar on the names of Allah tomorrow. And we're going to be starting tomorrow, inshallah, at La Trobe University. I was trying to remember the name, but been bouncing around, alhamdulillah. Last weekend I was in Perth, this weekend this is my first time visiting this beautiful city, Melbourne. I want to make sure that I say that right. But it's been mashallah, it's a great blessing when you're in a community and when you live in a place as beautiful as this. Many times people, they forget, when they live somewhere for a long time, they get bored with it. But I can tell you, as someone who's visiting, that it's amazing, actually, the city, the way that it's set up. And Sheikh Badr was telling me that Melbourne is actually the number one ranked most livable city in the world. Did you guys know that? Yeah, everybody knows that, huh? It's on everybody's fridge and stuff like that. So in any case, what we'll be discussing over the next 3 days, inshallah, is getting to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better. Getting to know Allah. In reality, we all are in need of spending a lot of time of our lives getting to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. We all learned that the greatest verse in the Quran is Ayatul Kursi. Well, what's Ayatul Kursi talking about that made it so great? It's talking about Allah. That's it. Not talking about anything else. We learned that Surah Al-Ikhlas is equal to 1/3 of the Quran. But what's Surah Al-Ikhlas talking about? It's just talking about Allah. Nothing else. We learned that Al-Fatiha is the greatest chapter of the Quran. It's the greatest surah in the Quran. But what's Surah Al-Fatiha talking about? Other than introducing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Malik, Yawm al-Din, and then introducing our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and then our request from this Lord of ours that we worship, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ, that we be able to worship Him properly. And so, realizing that any time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is studied, then that is the greatest endeavor, and that is the most noble endeavor. You know, there's a verse, the last verse in Surah Al-Talaq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الله الذي خلق سبع سماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن يتنزل الأمر بينهن. Allah says, Allah is the one who created seven heavens, and He created earths that are equal to it. And He says the command descends from the heavens to the earth. The question then becomes, why? Why the creation of seven heavens? Why the creation of earths equal? Why the revelation that descends and the command? Allah says, لِتَعْلَمُ, that you may come to know. Come to know what? أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَحَاطَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا, that you may come to know that Allah is able to do all things, and that Allah has encompassed everything with His mercy, and that Allah has encompassed everything with His knowledge. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is creating all of this so that we can get to know who Allah is, so that we may come to know who Allah is. And the greatest loss is not that a person goes through their life not knowing who their father is, not knowing who their mother is. Even though we all understand that if a person had the opportunity and they didn't know who their parents were, they would leave no stone unturned. They would embark on travel throughout the world to be able to meet that person, just because they know that there are questions that they would need to have answered that they will not be able to answer about themselves until they know who their mother or their father is. And yet, the greatest loss is not that a person doesn't know who their parents are. The greatest loss is that a person goes through life not knowing who Allah is, not knowing who created them. And so spending time learning about the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I wanted to give this an example, just one of the names that we'll be going over in the seminar. And that is a beautiful name of Allah. And I want you to appreciate something even before talking about that. If you were to ask the average Muslim, when I say average Muslim, I don't mean you guys. Because the average Muslim is not praying Maghrib in the masjid, right? The average Muslim is not praying Isha in the masjid. The average Muslim is probably closer to non-practicing than practicing. And so if you were to ask the average Muslim about whether Allah is pleased with them or angry with them, if they are close to Allah or distant from Allah, you would find that they would be more inclined to say that they feel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is distant from them. And no one would say that except if someone did not know who Allah is. And so part of learning about who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so that you can become someone who is a communicator of hope to your brothers and sisters and your cousins and your friends and the ummah at large. Because Allah, when He introduces Himself to us, He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Did you catch that? Did you pay attention to that? The basmala, what two attributes are mentioned? You say Bismillah what? Ar-Rahman and what? Now isn't that interesting? Why are both of those two attributes coming from the concept of Rahmah? Why? If you've already covered Rahmah with Ar-Rahman, couldn't the second word have been Al-Kareem? Couldn't the second word have been Al-Aziz, the Mighty? You already covered Rahmah, right? And yet we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, this is the introduction to every surah except for chapter 9, Surah At-Tawbah. But every other surah, the introduction is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, both names coming from the attribute of mercy. So what then is Allah communicating to us? And then in Surah Al-Fatiha, again we see ar-Rahman ar-Rahim coming again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ahzab, وَبَشِّرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ بِأَنَّ لَهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ فَضْلًا كَبِيرًا. Give glad tidings to the believers that they enjoy from Allah incredible grace. There is incredible fadl from Allah. There is incredible mercy from Allah. There is incredible love from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The question is, do we give people that good news? Or do we even know it ourselves? And one of the things that we do in the seminar is we talk about the pairings of the names. Why does Allah pair this name with that name? Why does Allah pair this name with that name? You'll find that every pairing of names, of course, is there for a purpose. We know that every letter of the Quran is there for a particular purpose. There's nothing that is random there. But at the same time, every parent of name is used to create a additional layer of meaning. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for example, in Surah Al-Buruj, He says, وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الْوَدُودُ. Right? ذُو الْعَرْشِ الْمَجِيدُ فَعَالُ لِمَا يُرِيدُ وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الْوَدُودُ. You know, this name of Allah, Al-Wadud, appears in two places in the Quran. It appears in Surah Hud and it appears in Surah Al-Buruj. Now the question becomes, why the pairing of Al-Ghafoor and Al-Wadud together? You know, Al-Ghafoor means the forgiving. Al-Wadud means the one who, exactly, loves. That being said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pairs these two things together, what is being communicated to us? Let me give you an example. There are some people who you might love very much in your life. Maybe a friend that you've had your entire life, maybe a family member or what have you, and you love them very deeply, and then what ends up happening is they, for example, they betray you. They steal from you. They harm you in some way. That hurt is so deep that even if after a while you are able to forgive them, are you ever able to love them again in the same way? Yes or no? Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he stood in front of a man. And this man had killed his brother Zayd ibn al-Khattab. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, there were a lot of false prophets, and even before the Prophet ﷺ died, Musaylim al-Kadhaf had declared himself to be a prophet. And he had wrote a letter to Rasulullah ﷺ, and he said, from Musaylima Rasulullah to Muhammad Rasulullah, Allah has divided up the earth between you and me in halves, but Quraysh are an oppressive people, like you're transgressing your bounds. It's split evenly between both of us. And so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote a letter back to Musaylima, and he said, May Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ila Musaylima al-Kadhab, to Musaylima the liar. Inna al-ard lillah, the earth all belongs to Allah. Yurithu liman yasha, Allah gives it to whomever He wishes. وَالْعَاقِبَ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, and the end is always for the righteous. In any case, the Prophet ﷺ is obviously rejecting the notion that he is a messenger of Allah. Nonetheless, Musaylimah's tribe, and he was from a very large tribe, they backed him up. And so Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent the army of Khalid ibn al-Walid against Musaylimah. In that battle, Zayd ibn al-Khattab is martyred, the brother of Umar. And so now years later, when Umar is the Amir al-Mu'mineen, Musaylimah's tribe, when they were defeated by Khalid, they re-entered into Islam. And Musaylimah himself was killed. They re-entered into Islam. And so now Umar radiallahu anhu is standing in front of the man who killed his brother Zayd and had entered into Islam again. And so Umar says to him, I ask you by Allah, did you kill my brother Zayd? Now you have to know who Zayd is for Umar. Zayd radiallahu anhu was his older brother, Ibn al-Khattab. Zayd accepted Islam before Umar. Zayd migrated before Umar. Zayd was always someone who believed in Umar and encouraged him. You know, when you have that amazing older brother, that's who Zayd was for Umar. And so Zayd is martyred. And Umar radiallahu anhu, he used to say, whenever I would feel a wind blowing from the south, I would remember my brother Zayd. Any wind that came from the direction of Yamama, any direction from where Musaylimah and that battle had taken place, he would say, I would remember my brother Zayd. And so this man, he's standing in front of him, and we know Umar's character and his personality and his harshness and his strength. He says, did you kill my brother Zayd? And that man says to Umar, yes, I did. Umar radiallahu anhu says to him, well then, stay away from me, because I will never love you like the earth doesn't love blood. And we're never going to mix. We're never going to be okay. And so he says to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, is your lack of love for me going to make me lose out on any of my rights? Am I going to become like a second class citizen now in Medina because you don't love me? And then Umar says to him, no, you're going to have all of your rights as a Muslim. My love is one thing and your rights are a completely different thing. And so that man then said, well, what do I care about your rights then? He said, what do I care about your love then? I don't care about your love. إِنَّمَا يَبْكِ عَلَى الْحُبِّ النِّسَاءِ. He says, the only people who care about love are women. I don't care about your love. But what is this conversation showing us? It shows us that this man had done such an injury to Umar by killing his brother radiallahu anhu, that Umar is saying to him, I do not have the capacity to love you anymore. Maybe if you had never killed Zayd and you had accepted Islam, we could have been very, very friendly. But because of that injury, and don't be amazed at that, because someone even greater than Umar radiallahu anhu, Al-Bukhari reports to us that when Wahshi, the killer of Hamza, stood in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and accepted Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, he said, can you please just keep your face away from me? I accept your Islam, I accept your... but I just don't want to see you. That's all. I don't want to remember every time I see your face the mutilation of Hamza, the way that he died, the body that was laying there in Uhud, the stomach that's cut open. I don't want to see all of that. And so even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was harm that could be done to him, and look at how much he forgave. He forgave Abu Sufyan, and he forgave Khalid, and he forgave Ikrimah, the son of Abu Jahl, and all of these losses that had been occurred over the years. He forgives and he welcomes. But Wahshi had done such an injury that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to him, this right here, this is my limit. And so when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls himself Al-Ghafoor Al-Wadud, what is that telling us? That this is a level that no human being can reach. This is above and beyond. There is nothing that a person can do while they are alive where they cannot be forgiven by Allah, and not just be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's not a single person walking on this earth right now, 7 billion people, I don't care what they've done, how evil they are, how much harm they have caused, there is not a single person who cannot not only be forgiven by Allah, but to be loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single person on this earth has the potential and the capacity to be forgiven by Allah and to be loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He calls himself Al-Ghafoor Al-Wadud, the forgiving and the loving. And so seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness and knowing Allah's names and attributes inspires in a person continuous hope, because they know they are not dealing with any human beings. They are dealing with a Lord who has Asma Husna. You know what Asma Husna? When we reflect on the names of Allah, it begins to show us who it is truly that we worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have called his names anything. He could have called them Al-Asma Al-Kubra. He could have called them the great names. He could have called them Al-Ughma. He could have called them the grandiose names. And yet he calls them the beautiful names. So what does that tell you about the Lord that you worship? What does that tell you about him? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses names for himself, so every king and every queen, when they have titles, these titles that they use for themselves are titles that they want to, this is information that they want to communicate to to their subjects and to their enemies. And so you have Richard the Lionheart, or you have Ivan the Terrible, or you have whoever, this person and that person. And everyone's using titles because this is something that's so important. They want this particular aspect of them to be very well known. And so when we look at what names does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose for himself? Of his names, for example, is Al-Wahhab. You know what Al-Wahhab means? The giver of gifts. A hiba is a gift. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls himself the giver of gifts. You know, if I had a friend whose nickname was the gift giver, like, that would be the best friend ever, right? And so when you have a Lord whose name is the gift giver, how beautiful is that? One of the things that we experience when we learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is we experience happiness. Why? Because I become happy that I am so privileged and fortunate to be able to worship a Lord that is so beautiful. I become so happy and fortunate that when everybody else is worshiping whatever they worship, that I get to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And hence the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in Sahih Muslim, ذَاقَ طَعْمَ الْإِيمَانِ, that person has tasted the sweetness of faith. Who has tasted the sweetness of faith? مَنْ رَضِيَ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّهُ وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينَ وَبِمُحَمَّدٍ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam نَبِيًا. That person has tasted the sweetness of faith, whoever is pleased with Allah as their Lord and is pleased with Islam as their religion. They would not trade Islam for anything else. I'm not burdened by the fact that I'm Muslim. I'm not embarrassed by the fact that I'm Muslim. I am not saddened by the fact that I wouldn't trade it for any other way of life. And is pleased with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as their messenger. I would not follow anyone other than him. There's nobody in the history of humanity that I would prefer to name myself to be a follower of than Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Hashim al-Qurashi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so, following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, one of the things that we need to do when it comes to the names of Allah, as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says that Allah loves those people who adorn themselves with his characteristics. What do I mean by that? Ibn al-Qayyim says, Allah is alimun yuhibbul ulama. Allah is knowledgeable, he loves the people of knowledge. Kareemun, he is kareem, he loves the people of generosity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is qawi, wal mu'min al-qawi, khayrun wa habibun Allah min al-mu'min al-da'if. Allah is strong and he loves the strong believer. He even loves the shy. And so when we look at the attributes of Allah, we ask ourselves the question, what share do I have from these characteristics? And so the one, since we were talking about al-wadud, the loving, I wanted to look at some of the ways that we can interact with this name, wud, the loving. Am I someone who loves my brothers and sisters? Do I love people? Because, or do I hate people? Because a person cannot give da'wah to people that they hate. It just doesn't work. Even when we talk about rahmah, rahmah is desiring good for people. That is what mercy is. And so if a person is merciful to people, they always want goodness for them. I want goodness for my neighbor. I want goodness for my family members. I want goodness for my country and my fellow countrymen. I want goodness for humanity. And so, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is described as being rahma lil alameen. He is a rahma for all of the worlds because he desired goodness for everyone. He desired goodness for everything. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a mercy for everything. Now that being said, Am I someone who loves? Do I love what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves? Do I love Allah? There's a lot to be unwrapped in all of these questions. Number one, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Loving Allah is something that everyone will say that they do. Everyone, and they don't have to be Muslim. Anybody who believes in God will tell you that they love God. Whether they're Christian or Jewish or whoever they are, they will declare love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah in Surah Al-Imran, He gives us a test for that. And He says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. Say, if you love Allah, then do what? فَاتَّبِعُونِ. Then follow me. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being told by Allah to tell mankind, say, if you love Allah, then follow me. Because anybody who ever loves, their objective, their goal isn't just to love. That's not the goal of anybody who loves, right? Your goal is what? Your goal is for that love to be returned. If you love someone, it's not enough to just love them. You want them to love you too. If you're a kid, you want your parents to love you. If you're a parent, you want your kids to love you. If you love someone, you want that person to love you back. That's just the way that it goes. Everybody wants their love to be reciprocated. And so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you love Allah, then follow me. Follow who? Follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? If you do that, yuhibbukumullah. Allah will love you. And you'll get that love back. And this verse is called the verse of the test. Why? Because anybody who declares that they love Allah but are not willing to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then that person's love is not truthful. That person's love is not sincere. That person's love is not pure. Because when a person sincerely loves, they are willing to do anything for that love to be reciprocated. That's why we have all of these stories of people who are in love, who do the craziest things. Why do they do the craziest things when they're in love? Because they want that love to be returned. And so they drive crazy distances. And they do crazy things. And they spend nights and nights and nights talking on the phone and doing all of these things. And for them, is it a burden for them to do all of these things? No, it's not. Why? Because everything becomes insignificant when the task is so beloved and so dear. And that's similar to this concept, that when a person's goal is great, then everything that they do becomes easy and insignificant to acquire such a great goal. Now, that's number one, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, wanting to love the actions that garner us Allah's love. A lot of times, what prevents us is two things. Not loving the actions that garner us Allah's love. And number two is loving the things that distance us from Allah. And these are real problems. What happens when a person does not enjoy salah? What happens when a person does not enjoy fasting? What happens when a person does not enjoy ibadah? They do not find it pleasant or pleasurable. It's great if you enjoy it, but what happens to the person who doesn't? And number two, what happens to the person who is on the other end? They enjoy a particular sin or many sins. They enjoy these things. Their heart finds rest in them. What then? And they know that it's a problem for them. What then? And so, when we learn about the names of Allah, there is theory and there's practice. The theory is to learn about the concepts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names. But the practice, Allah tells us in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-A'raf, He says, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Allah says, to Allah belong the most beautiful names, so call upon Him by those names. The point is that the reason why Allah told us His beautiful names is for us to call upon Him by those names. And so the question that we all have to ask ourselves is, when do we call upon Allah by His names? Do I call upon Allah by His name Al-Fattah? Have I called upon Allah in this entire year by His name As-Samad once? Have I called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His name Al-Wahhab or Al-Razzaq or Al-Majid? Do I call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His name Al-Mu'min? Do I even know what these names mean? The reality is that many of us, when it comes to dua, we are very, very robotic. We don't even think about the things that we are saying and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I had one of my teachers, he used to teach kids. And so he used to say, when I would teach the kids in the masjid, I would teach them salah, like 7-year-old kids, 8-year-old, I'm teaching them salah. I used to teach them to make dua for me in every salah. Okay? I would teach them to make dua for me in every salah. Why would he do that? Because he said, I know that they are not going to change the du'as they make in salah for the rest of their life. You learn when you are 7 years old, when you go into sujood to say, رَبِّ رَحْمُهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَا صِغِيرًا, and so you make that for the rest of your life. And that's a good one, you should keep that one. But whatever others, the point is that a person, dua should not be something that is stagnant, and it should not be something that is static. Every day of your life is different, isn't it? The things that you need now in your life was not what you needed last year, and it's not what you need 5 years from now, and it's not what you needed 10 years from now. So why is it that many of us, too many of us, when we make dua, we are literally saying the same dua that we learned 20 years ago? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to Allah belong the most beautiful names, so call upon Him by those names. So one of the things that we spend a lot of time doing is working on being able to talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Being able to talk to Him in whatever way you are comfortable, in whatever language you are comfortable. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows all languages, and He's familiar with all of them. And so recognizing that and being comfortable in speaking. But coming back to our point, is what happens if a person does not experience pleasure with regards to the ibadat, and they have particular sins that they enjoy too much. We learn du'as that we need to make. Of them, the Prophet ﷺ taught us to say, Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbak. Oh Allah, I ask You for Your love. Wa hubba man yuhibbuk. And the love of those whom You love. Wa hubba amalin yuqarribuni ila hubbik. And the love of actions that will garner Me Your love. So three things. I ask You to love You. I want to love You, O Allah. So I ask You that. And it can also be understood, I ask You for Your love of Me. I want You to love Me. Number two, I ask You for the love of those whom You love. And number three, I ask You to love the actions that You love. Make me love reading the Quran. I know Ramadan is coming, and I go days and days and days without reading the Quran. To be honest, I don't enjoy it. And so let me enjoy reading the Quran. Oh Allah, plant that seed in my heart. Oh Allah, I may not enjoy the salah. So make me love that. Make me love sadaqah. Right now I don't love sadaqah at all. So make me enjoy sadaqah. So that when we have the 20 fundraisers in Ramadan, that I'm able to enjoy donating. Right? Make me enjoy these things. Make me love the things that You love. And if there's something that I love that You don't love, then make me not love it also. And there's a beautiful supplication for that. Allahumma habbib ilayna al-iman. Make faith beloved to us. Wazayyinhu fi qulubina. And beautify it in our hearts. Wakarrih ilayna al-kufra wal-fusuqa wal-isyan. Oh Allah, make faith beloved to us and beautify it in our hearts. And make hated to us disbelief and Fusuq, transgression, and disobedience, asyan. You know, there is a brother who once called, he called one of those fatwa hotlines with the sheikh. So he called the sheikh and he said, "Sheikh, I have a problem, man. I have, there's this, I'm in love, and I need to get her out of my head." And so the sheikh said, "I have a dua for you. Say, oh Allah, ij'al min amali nura. Oh Allah, make nur, light in front of me. Wa min khalfi nura, and from behind me, light, nur. And from the right of me, nur. And from the left of me, nur. And in my heart, nur." And the guy interrupted and he said, "Sheikh, you are killing me. Her name is Noor." Right? So the point here is that asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you, to assist you in worshipping Him and worshipping Him beautifully. That's number two. And number three is with regards to loving people. I want to share with you, and we're done now, inshallah ta'ala. I wanted to share with you a number of things that help us to love each other. Because we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Al-Wadud, that He made it that loving for His sake is an incredibly rewardable action. We learn that on the Day of Judgment that seven people will be in the shade of Allah, in the shade of His throne. Seven categories of people. And of the categories of people are two people who loved each other for the sake of Allah. And so then the question becomes, and the Prophet ﷺ, he told us that the people who love each other for His sake, only for His sake, they will be sitting ala manabir min nur. They will be sitting on pulpits of light on the Day of Judgment. They will be envied by the prophets and the martyrs. So why is loving for the sake of Allah so valuable? You have to understand that all of us, we love for our own sake. That's how we naturally love. I love for my own sake. You love for your own sake. Everybody here loves for their own sake. I love my parents very much. Why do I love my parents? Because they took care of me, they nourished me, they educated me, they provided for me, they protected me, they raised me, right? I do not necessarily love your parents, right? Whereas you love your parents very much, for the same reason, at the end of each equation is you. Just like at the end of my equation is me. I love my friends very much. They help me, support me, love me, right? I may not necessarily like your friends very much. So when you love for the sake of Allah, what you have done is you've removed yourself from being the center. And you are not loving people because they orbit around you, which is our natural disposition. I am loving this person not because they orbit around me. I have removed myself from being the center of the equation, and I am now loving them because Allah is the center. And so I love them not because they orbit around me, but I love them because they orbit around Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so I love that brother not because he does me anything, any favors, but I love him because he's always in the first row. He's always calling the adhan. He's always here for the salah. She's always giving sadaqah. She's always reading the Quran. I love that sister because of her closeness to Allah, not because of her closeness to me. And so loving for the sake of Allah becomes a profound act of worship. And so what are some of the things that we can do to increase love for one another? Number one is to think about people with their best attributes. It's very easy for you to, if you just look at the negative that people have, it's very easy for you to dislike them. There are some people who they always see what's negative. They never see what's positive. Why is this person dressed like this? Why is this person, you know, why does this place look like this? They're always looking for that which is negative, and so it becomes easy for them to stand out. And it becomes easy for you to dislike that. But if you're always looking for the positive, well, you'll find that too. And so there was a companion who drank alcohol a number of times. The first time the Prophet ﷺ had him punished. The second time he drank alcohol, the Rasulullah ﷺ had him punished again. The third time he was punished again. But this time, the third time, the Sahaba were so upset, they themselves became upset that this man keeps coming back. And so they said, "Akhzak Allah." They said to the man, "Akhzak Allah, may Allah humiliate you." And so the Prophet ﷺ said to them, "We have a rule, guys. The rule is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, 'Inna Allaha malaikatahu yusalluna 'ala an-nabi. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sallu 'alayhi wa sallimu taslima.'" And so I know what you guys are doing. When I say Rasulullah, you guys blink, and the blink means sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it's not. Blinking does not mean sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You actually have to say it, okay? So say it one more time. Hey, mashallah. Dhikr of Allah has to be pronounced. Dhikr cannot be said in the heart. It's not called dhikr then. Just like you can't read the Quran, if I open up my Quran app, I can't read the Quran silently, like I would read a newspaper. You don't get the reward of reading the Quran that way. So if I'm reading, right? But you cannot read the Quran silently. You can't sit and say, "I'm making tasbih." If my lips are not moving and my tongue is not moving, you don't get the reward for it. Similarly, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has to be pronounced. You don't have to say it out loud, but your lips have to move. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the stingiest person is who? The person who, when I am mentioned in his presence, he does not say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if the only thing we got out of this gathering, the only thing that you ever get out of a gathering, is that you hear Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like 150 times before the gathering is over, that's enough of a benefit for sitting in a masjid like this. And included in that is that it's Friday night right now. It's Friday night, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the best days is Jum'ah. And so send a lot of salah upon me. No, but it's Friday night Islamically. Right? Friday night Islamically. The night is before the day. So right now it's Friday night. Okay, so we were saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "La tu'inu shaytana ala akhikum." He said, "Do not assist shaytan against your brother." And then he said, "Innahu yuhibbullaha wa rasulahu." Why? Because he loves Allah and his messenger. And so even though this person is being brought to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in an intoxicated frame, he sees through that frame and he sees a heart that beats with the love of Allah and his messenger. And so looking at people with their best attributes. Number two is communicating love. Many people, they never tell anybody that they love them. Because that's not part of my culture. I don't know if it's part of Aussie culture. Do you guys say "I love you" here? You guys do? You guys are looking at me like you've never, ever, ever. But there's something important that I want you all to know. Is that when we have something that is encouraged by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then we have something that is not part of our culture, maybe you're from a family where you've never said "I love you" ever. You've never heard your father say it, you've never heard your grandfather say it, you've never heard your mother say it, right? But then you have something where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that if one of you loves one another, he should tell them. So what do you now have to do? You have to break with your culture. You have to. Because every week, Salatul Jum'ah, you hear, وَخَيْرُ الْهَدِي هَدِي مُحَمَّد sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The best guidance is the hadi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's better than any culture that we have. If Islam does not clash with culture, then al-'ada muhakkama. Culture is fine. There's nothing wrong with having culture. Islam is supposed to look Australian in Australia. And Islam is supposed to look Senegalese in Senegal. And Islam is supposed to look Turkish in Turkey. And Islam is supposed to look Bengali in Bangladesh. There's nothing wrong with that. But when we have aspects of our culture clash with instruction of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the instruction of Allah, then Islam supersedes our culture. There was a man who once Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was kissing his children, his grandchildren, and this man he bragged to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, "Atuqabbiru abna'ak? Do you kiss your children? I have 10 children. I've never kissed any of them." MashaAllah, right? Yeah. I've never kissed any of them. Yani in some of our cultures, we have that. You have the husband or the father, he's never carried any of his children. And they brag about that. I've never carried any of my children. I've never done this for my children. I've never cleaned my children. I've never done, right? And they brag about this. And so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't say, MashaAllah, what a man you are. He said, "What do you want me to do if Allah has removed mercy from your heart? Man la yarham la yurham." It's a very powerful statement. He says, whoever does not show mercy will not experience mercy. And communicating love, I want you to just appreciate something. That no matter how tough your house is, your family, no matter how foreign this concept is from your culture, the Sahaba came from an even harsher culture. The Sahaba came from an even rougher culture. The Sahaba came from a culture where Allah says, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. That when one of them was given the news of a daughter, their face would darken, and they would hide from the people. يَتَوَالَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ أَيُمْسِكُهُ عَلَى هُونٍ أَمْ يَدُسُهُ فِي التُّرَابِ. He then has to make the choice. Does he raise this girl in humiliation or does he bury her in the sand? What an evil decision they make. And yet, that's the culture, right? That's the culture. What does Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam do with that culture? He comes to lead the salah and he's carrying his daughter, Umama bint Zainab. He's carrying the daughter of his daughter. He'd pick her up and he'd come lead the salah, carrying his baby granddaughter. In front of those men who just recently were burying those types of girls in the sand. He's breaking those cultural barriers. The Prophet ﷺ would then put her down and he would go into sujood. And when he would get up, he would not leave her on the ground. He would pick her back up, communicating that love again. So number two, we said communicating love. And so the homework from this lecture tonight is that you go and you tell somebody that you love them. And if it's still too hard for you, Allah has made it easier. Send them a text message.
WhatsApp.
Send it on WhatsApp. But WhatsApp is a problem because you might delete it. You might get nervous and delete it. Well, I'm an easy way out. No, you need to somebody else. أحببك الذي أحببتني فيه. So that's number two. Number three is so we said communicating love. Number three is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ told us. He says, لا تدخل الجنة حتى تؤمنوا. You will not enter paradise until you believe. ولا تؤمنوا حتى تحبوا. And you won't believe until you love one another. So you won't enter paradise until you believe, and you won't believe until you love one another. أَفَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ إِذَا فَعَلْتُمُوهُ تَحَابَبْتُمْ. Shall I not tell you about something that if you do it, you will love one another? أَفْشُ السَّلَامَ بَيْنَكُمْ. Spread the salam amongst each other. When you walk into a masjid, there's always two options that you have. You can scan the group and see, do I know anybody here? And if I see somebody that I know, I say salam to them. And everybody else I ignore. Or afshu salam. Afshu salam means that you spread the salam. You spread the salam. You spread the salam to those who you know and those who you don't know. That sister who walks up to you and says salamu alaykum, do you respond to her or do you ignore her and you pretend that she didn't say anything? And this is a complaint that you get with masajid many times. A sister will come and she'll say that I went to the masjid and I said salamu alaykum to the sister and they didn't respond to me. So you know what? I don't want to come here anymore. A brother will come, say salam, salam, salam. not get any response. Doesn't want to come here anymore. The salam makes people welcome. Salam increases love. Salatul Jum'ah tomorrow, when you're leaving the masjid, you have that same option. You can either scan just looking for the people that you know, or you can spread salam to everybody that you know and those that you don't know. Strangers are friends that you haven't met yet. Strangers are simply friends that you haven't met yet. Number four is to smile. Is to smile. Why is smiling important? You know how like none of you are smiling right now? Smiling, as one of my mashayikh used to tell me, he used to say, smile. Your teeth are not awra. They're not awra. There you go. Why is a smile important? Because when you smile, I know where I'm at. The outback, Australia, a lot of tough guys. But I doubt anybody here is tougher than Khalid ibn Walid. Khalid radiallahu anhu, Saifullah, he tells us that when he accepted Islam, he came to Medina, his brother was already Muslim. His brother told him, Rasulullah has heard about your arrival, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is overjoyed and he's waiting for you. He's waiting for you right now. So Khalid doesn't have any time, he has to go straight. And so he goes. So what does he remember? Remember, he's telling us this years and years after this incident had happened. He says, فَلَمَّا رَآنِي مِن بَعِيدٍ When Rasulullah saw me from a distance, تَبَسَّمَ فِي وَجْهِ He smiled at me. He smiled. فَوَاللَّهِ لَمْ يَزَلْ مُبْتَسِمًا حَتَّى وَقَفْتُ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ He says, the Prophet ﷺ continued to smile until I stood in front of him. That smile was unbroken. He just kept smiling and smiling and smiling and smiling. That's what he remembered. Why? So when you have when you smile at somebody, and that smile makes that person feel welcome, and that smile makes that person feel comfortable, when that smile makes that person feel loved, then you can understand how Rasulullah ﷺ, he said, تَبَسُّمُكَ فِي وَجْهِ أَخِيكَ Sadaqah, that a smile that you cast in the face of your brother or sister is a sadaqah that you give. It's a charity that you give. And then the last one that I'll mention is the last thing that we can do to increase love for each other is to bring happiness to each other. Is to bring happiness to each other. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was asked many times, he was asked the question, what is the most beloved action to Allah? And he would give many very different question, different answers depending on the circumstance. But on one occasion he said, Sururun tudkhilhu ala Muslim. Happiness that you bring to a Muslim. Happiness. Any happiness. Surur in Arabic is nakira, which means that it is an indefinite article. Or it is indefinite, which means any happiness that you bring to any Muslim at any time. So even before tonight is over, you can bring happiness to a Muslim. Somehow. You can, for example, donate a dollar online to some charity, and that'll bring happiness to a Muslim somewhere. You can comment on someone's Facebook status and say, Mubarak on your graduation, Mubarak on your engagement, Mubarak on your marriage, as you're scrolling down your feed. And don't you get happy when you see people congratulate you? So wouldn't they get happy when they get congratulated? Right? Something as simple as that. The weekend is approaching. Helping somebody, for example, move, or helping them in any capacity. Any happiness that you bring to any Muslim becomes the most beloved action to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us. And so any happiness that you bring. And I'll conclude with a story, because the Sahaba taught us this, and they learned it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one night is with Abu Bakr and Umar, and they're both out very late. And so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is making his way back to the masjid, and because he's going home, the house of Aisha is a room that opens up into the masjid. So he would walk into the masjid to get to the house of Aisha. Abu Bakr and Umar are walking back with him. And when they enter into the masjid, there are some people who used to live in the masjid, Ahlul Suffa, and one of them is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud has gotten up to pray Qiyam. It's late at night and they have gotten up to pray Qiyam. And Abdullah is praying behind one of the pillars in the masjid and he's reciting Quran. And the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hears Abdullah's recitation and it's so perfect. that the Prophet is listening and listening and listening, and then he looks to Abu Bakr and Umar and he says, whoever of you wants to hear the Quran fresh, like it was revealed, let him listen to the recitation of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And you can't get a better and so Abdullah ibn Mas'ud doesn't know the Prophet is behind him listening. So he's making dua in the salah. And Rasulullah is saying to him, قُلْ يُسْمَعْ قُلْ يُسْمَعْ قُلْ يُسْمَعْ. Say it will be heard, say it will be heard. And then Rasulullah goes into the house. Umar, the next morning, he wakes up and he's on a mission. He's looking for Abdullah ibn Mas'ud from the morning time. He's going and looking and looking and looking. Finally, he finds Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and he says to him, I just wanted to let you know that last night we were with the Prophet ﷺ and you were reciting the Quran. It was such a beautiful recitation. And the Prophet ﷺ said this and this and this and this. And I just wanted to let you know that. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says to him, Jazakallah khair, I heard all of this already. Heard it already. Like the first thing in the morning. Who'd you hear it from? Abu Bakr. So Umar says, it's no use. I've never been able to beat Abu Bakr to any good. But the question is, what was the good that Umar was trying to beat Abu Bakr to? What was the good? The good is just to meet Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and give him a little bit of news. Excuse me. A little bit of news that will make him happy. That's it. And so not belittling any good action that we can do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us and grant us His love and the love of those whom He loves and the love of actions that grant us His love. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adorn faith in our hearts and beautify it for us and make us this hate, disbelief in transgression and disobedience. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with the prophets and the martyrs and the righteous and the truthful in paradise. And what excellent companions are those. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.